So good afternoon everyone. So in the last class we have studied the starting methods of single phase induction motor. So in which we have studied resistor split phase motor. So we will now today again we will see resistor split phase induction motor. Okay. So in this type of induction motor there are two types of winding. Okay. Auxiliary winding and main winding. Okay. So this is a cage rotor of the induction motor. And we have two windings. This is main winding. And for richer to it, we have second winding, that is winding A. Okay, so two windings, one is our auxiliary winding and another one is main winding. Okay. So it is connected to a centrifugal switch. Okay. So flux in main winding is phi m and this is phi a. Okay, so this is main winding or running winding. Okay, and this is auxiliary winding. So why we need these two windings? Because if we use only main winding or running winding, so EMF MMF produced by this main winding is pulsating and stationary. So your winding, so this rotor is not self starting. Okay. So now we have this two winding and. you can draw its circuit diagram. So this is M, resistance of M, Rm and Xm reactance, and this is Ra and Xa with a plus minus V1, current is I1, so this is plus minus V1, current is Im and here it is Ia, so this is total I, okay, I, so this will be Im and this is Ia, okay, so this is auxiliary winding A, okay. So this main winding, as I told you earlier in last class, so it has got high reactance and low resistance. So why it should has high resistance? Because if we draw the phasor diagram. So this is V1 and this is Ia and this is Im. Okay, and angle between these two is beta. Okay, so for having a starting torque, so torque depends on sine alpha, angle between these two current. Okay, and here beta is 230 degree to 40 degrees. Okay. So initial torque in case of resistor split phase induction motor is very low. It is very low and it is up to 0.5 to 2 times of the full load torque. Okay. So it is very low. So angle between these two Ia and Im is 90 degree. Okay. So this is phi m, and flux produced in auxiliary winding is phi a, and the resultant of these two gives total I. Okay, so this is the phasor diagram of the single phase induction motor. Okay, so if we draw the impedance triangle, so this is theta m, this is r m, and this is x m, and this is z m. Okay, so the theta m is equal to tan inverse x m by r m. Okay, so if you want to find the more difference between this IA and IM, okay, so why we need this difference? Because if there is large beta, so sorry, this will be beta here, so torque will be greater, so there should be displacement, greater displacement between IA and IM. Okay, and for let's say theta a, this is r a, x a, and z a. Okay, so tan inverse theta a will be equal to x a upon r a. Okay, so this theta m and theta a depends on x a and x a by r a and x m by r m. Okay, so this depends on theta m is equal to tan inverse x m by r. Okay, so the xm by ra rm must be greater than ra by ra, xa by ra, to have greater value of beta. So if we have greater value of beta, so we have large or maximum starting torque. Okay, so in this case the angle between these two current, armature, this is auxiliary winding current and main winding current, is not 90 degree, they are not quadrature to each other. So that's why resistance series phase induction motor is sometimes also referred as unbalanced two phase induction motor. So this is unbalanced two phase induction motor. Okay, so why it is unbalanced two phase induction motor? In balanced two phase induction motor, so angle between IM and IA must be 90 degree, and here it is less than 90 degree, it is something between 30 to 40 degrees. Okay, so that why it behaves at the time of starting. So it behaves, so at the time of starting, so it behaves as unbalanced two phase induction motor. Okay, so resistance split phase induction motor is can be referred as unbalanced two phase induction motor at the time of starting, because the angle between IA and IM is not equal to 90 degree. For balance two phase induction motor or two phase motor, so the angle between auxiliary current, auxiliary winding and main winding is 90 degree. Okay, so if we want to increase this angle, so the ratio phi xm by rm must be greater than xa by ra. Okay, so that means the angle, okay, so this is v1 and this is ia and this is im, so angle between VM, let's suppose this will be theta M and this will be theta A and this is beta. So beta will be equal to phi M minus phi M. And this phi M and phi A depends on the ratio of XA by RA and XM upon RA. Okay. So in order to have greater beta, so this phi M should be greater. Okay. So this will be, and the difference between this, so that that means that phi M should be greater. Okay. So phi M is greater. So this for that XM, XM upon RM must be greater than RA upon XM, and this will be, this should be minimum. So this difference should be high. Okay. So this is why this condition must satisfy. Okay. So what we do, so for increasing phi m, so let's suppose this is the stator of single phase induction motor and here the slots are having double layer, so these are double windings, is double layer. Okay, so at the bottom we have m main winding and top we have auxiliary winding. Okay, so why we are doing like this? So this is m dash and this is a dash. Okay, so if it is kept at the bottom of the slot, so there will be more leakage flux, and if there is more leakage flux, the value of XM will be greater. Okay, so that's why we kept keep this main winding. So this is a double layer winding, so the main winding is kept at the bottom of the slot and the auxiliary winding is kept at the top of the slot, okay, which is near to the rotor of this induction motor. Okay, so if we keep this winding nearer to the rotor, so this will have less leakage reactance, therefore XA with XM will be greater than XA. Okay, so this is how we increase the value of XM. Okay, now if you want to the value of RM should be less, okay, in order to have this ratio greater than this, so RM will be less. Okay, so so RM will be thick wire, so resistance will be less, and RA will be a thin wire. Okay, as R is equal to rho L upon A, so we are using thin wire, so automatically the area will be less, so the resistance of RA will increase. Okay, so what we are doing, we are decreasing the value of XA and increasing the value of RA, so automatically this ratio will be less. And what we are doing here, we are increasing the value of XM and decreasing the value of RM. Okay, so why we are doing this thing, so this is XM upon RM is equal to the tan inverse tan phi m. Okay, so phi m, so phi m depends on tan inverse XM upon RM, and this phi a is equal to tan inverse X upon RA. So in order to get maximum starting torque, in order to get maximum torque, you see phi must be maximum. Okay, So it should be maximum. So this phi must be greater and this phi a will be minimum. So this is maximum, this is minimum. So in this way we get phi maximum phi m and minimum phi a. And also the resistance is proportional to n square, number of turns is square. Okay, so that's why the RA has got less number of turns as compared to RM. Okay, so main winding has high reluctance, low resistance and large number of turns, and RA auxiliary winding has low reactance, high resistance and number of turns are less. Okay, so this is the limitation of this induction motor, because torque is proportional to sine beta, okay, and beta is equal to 30 degree, so we get very less starting torque. Okay, so in the last class we have seen that how torque is produced. Okay, so this is V1 and this is IA. Okay, so we will get, so since the reactance of this main winding is greater as compared to reactance of main winding, so IA will lead by beta degree. Okay, and so as a result, the stator field reaches its maximum. The stator field. Stator field reaches maximum. Okay, when maximum first along. Auxiliary winding axis. Okay, so this is leading IM. So the stator field reaches maximum when along the armature winding first. Okay, so this is M dash, this is A dash, so this is dot and this is cross. Okay, so it will get maximum along the auxiliary winding axis. Okay, and after beta degree it will get maximum along the And after beta degree, so let us suppose this is dot and this is cross, so it will be in this direction. So you will get the stator field will be maximum along the main winding axis. Okay, so in this way this magnetic field will rotate. Okay, so first along the, this is auxiliary winding axis. Okay, then after theta degree, so we will get maximum, this is main winding axis. Okay, so we will get torque in this direction. Okay, so this will move in anti-clockwise direction. Okay, so according to the connection you will get the clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction rotation. Okay, so this is how, then after 180 degree, so this will be in this direction and then the magnetic field will be in this direction. Okay, along the negative axis of auxiliary winding, and then beta degree after that, so this will be along the main winding axis in negative side. Okay, so we will get the maximum of stator field in this way. Okay, so this will be in anti-clockwise direction. So this will rotate in anti-clockwise direction. Okay, so in this way you can start the induction motor by using this auxiliary winding. Okay, so if you want to change the direction of the rotation of this motor, okay, so how we can do that? So we can change the polarity of the auxiliary winding or the main winding. Okay, so simply by changing the polarity of the by interchanging two terminals, either of auxiliary winding or main winding. Okay, so if I connect like this, now this will rotate in clockwise direction. Okay, so this will rotate in clockwise direction. Okay, so if you interchange the two terminals of either auxiliary winding or main winding, so the rotation of the rotor will change accordingly. Okay, so now if we draw the torque speed characteristics of the single phase induction motor, so this is per unit speed and this is per unit torque. So at the time of starting, so when only main winding is used, so starting torque is equal to 0. Okay, so when main winding is used, only main winding is used. Okay, now it is 1, this is 2 and 3 and 4 so on. So starting torque, if auxiliary winding is connected, so it will be somewhere between 1 and 2. Okay, so it will start from here. Okay, and at 80% of synchronous speed, okay, or 70 to 80% of synchronous speed, the starting winding gets disconnected automatically. Okay, so this get disconnected automatically. We have our speed torque characteristics like this. Okay, so at 70 to 80% of synchronous speed, this main winding, this auxiliary winding, this switch opens automatically. Okay, so what we are doing, we are giving sufficient starting torque, okay, by using this auxiliary winding. So this is auxiliary winding plus main winding. Okay, so at 70 to 80% of synchronous, your induction motor attained this 70 to 80% of this synchronous speed, so this auxiliary winding is automatically disconnected from the circuit. Okay, so what if it is this centrifugal switch fails to operate? Okay, so if there is armature, this auxiliary winding, it's get connected even after after the 70 to 80% of synchronous speed or during the normal operation. So as we know, the armature, the resistance of RA, this auxiliary winding, is quite large, then copper loss, that is I square R loss, will be very high. So this auxiliary winding is used for starting purpose only. Once your motor gets started, so if you disconnect this auxiliary winding, then also the motor will start and it will attain the rotor speed. Okay, so if suppose this synchronous speed, this centrifugal switch is failed to operate and this auxiliary winding is still connected to the circuit, so there will be high I square R loss because resistance of the auxiliary winding is quite large as compared to the main winding. Okay, so this should be get disconnected once it's got the 80% of the synchronous speed in order to avoid this high I square R loss. Okay, so this is the speed torque characteristics. So the starting torque lies between 1.5 to 2 2 per unit of the 2 times of the full load torque. Okay, and the efficiency of this motor is from 60 to 65%, and power factor is 0.55 to 0.65. okay, so this is the specification. So power factor is 0.5 to 0.65, efficiency is from 60% to 65%, and it is generally used 10 to 500 watt power requirement. So this is very small rating motor. Okay, that is half kilowatt motor. Okay, and application of this split phase induction motor is fan, blowers, and motors used in refrigerators. Okay, so it is generally used in refrigerators. Okay, so this type of motor is generally not used where there is frequent on and off operation is there. Because if this this centrifugal, it fails to operate, so then there will be high losses. occur. Okay, so this is generally not used where high on-off operation is there. Okay, so where very low on-off operation is there, so we generally go with this type of motor, that is resistant split phase motor. Okay, and the size and cost of this motor is quite low because it has only two windings are connected, and that two auxiliary winding gets disconnected after some time. Okay, so the cost and the size of this induction motor is very low, and only the limitation is that the starting torque is very low. It is up to 1.5 to 2 times of the full load torque. So one of the limitation is that. Okay. So this is the power rating, efficiency is 60 to 65%, power and power factor is this much. Okay, so if this auxiliary winding fails to this centrifugal switch is fails to operate, then there will be noisy operation. Okay, so there will be some noise introduced in the system. Okay, so this is all about the resistance split phase induction motor. Okay, so the resistance of the main winding is less, and resistance of armature winding is very large. Okay, that's why it is known as resistance split phase motor. So in the next class we will study capacitor split phase induction motor. So the angle between IA and IM should be 90 degrees in order to make it a balanced two-phase induction motor. Okay, so that's all for today's class. Any doubt you can ask. Okay, thank you, class.